Channel 7, ABC Chicago.
And good morning on a Friday morning, a kind of a bleak, rainy Friday morning. However, I hear the weather's supposed to clear up a little bit this weekend. By this afternoon, be relatively nice. After a tough day at the office, driving home, I will admit, I listen to them. Sometimes I laugh very hard. Sometimes I'm a little confused at what I'm listening to. But they really are two of Chicago's most popular and innovative radio personalities. They were shocked, as were many of us last week, by the sudden death of their close friend and colleague, Marcus Palmer. Marcus was a studio aide and a constant companion. His tragic death was all the more ironic and chilling in the light of Steve Dahl and Gary Meier's irreverent treatment of death in the past, a song parody of the John Wayne Gacy murders, a biting look at the demise and the legacy of Elvis Presley, and routines following the death of actor Paul Lynde. Those are just a few examples of some of the satirical, humorous manner in which they have treated death on the air. Steve Dahl and Gary Meier are with us this morning, along with Channel 7 critic at large, John Callaway. John, Gary, Steve, good morning.
Hi, Rob.
Good morning, Rob.
Gentlemen.
I thought we were coming here to talk about breath.
No.
I misunderstood. Like how celebrities keep their breath smelling fresh.
I want to be serious, at least for a bit, for starters. Because I had met Marcus when I came over to do Celebrity Jeopardy with you fellas. I had a nice chat with him. He's a fun guy, and I know you loved him both. You loved him. Has his death changed the way? Have you rethought the way that you handle death or satirize it?
Yeah.
How?
I was afraid you were going to ask the follow-up question. Well, I personally have never had to deal with death.
You mean
hitting that close to home?
You got your parents.
They're alive. My grandfather died, but he was 81. So, 81, you figure,
yeah,
that's a long life. That's okay. And we're never that close. Marcus's death. That was the closest that it's ever come to me, death. And so sure, yeah, I rethought it. I think I will always think now a little bit more before I dive into one of my satirical death raps.
Are you saying that you've got regrets on what you said in the past?
No. I think you can only be responsible for what you are at any given time. I mean, up until Marcus's death, I thought the way I thought. Now I think differently. I don't regret the way I thought in the past. That's just the way I thought. That was my frame of reference at that point.
What will you do differently now?
Well, like I said, I think I'll think more about the consequences of what I do in terms of the families of the people that have died. Because I guess I never really thought about that before, because the closest I ever came to death was just seeing it on TV, on the news and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Guyana, 912 people dead. Oh. And then it's, you don't think about the families of those people. You think about Jim Jones and how weird that all was. And I would sort of go off on that tangent because it doesn't seem real when you see it on your 17-inch tube. At least it didn't up until last week.
Gary, I want to get your thoughts on the same thing, too. Are you rethinking? Has it affected you in ways that surprised you? Did it scare you when Marcus died?
It scared me, but I had a close friend of mine die in a car accident, and he was 23, and I was the same age at the time. So this was very similar, and I remember my thoughts then, and they were very similar to what happened last week. I was very confused then, and I wanted to know more about death after that happened. So I really took an interest in finding more out about death. How much you can find out, I don't know, but I went to hear Dr. Kubler-Ross do a lecture at Northwestern once, and I just opened up a lot to death, whereas before I pushed it away.
Mm-hmm.
Never really touched me before that. Marcus's death once again came very close, and the next 36 hours after his death, I spent just really thinking about everything in general, and maybe we should be a little more reverent when we talk about people who have died. So I'm still going through that process right now. I mean, it's still very fresh in my mind.
John Callaway, you know, John did a five-part series on you in the 430. And John, what difference?
131-part series.
131.
It only seemed like 130, but it was actually 131-part series.
As you're listening to Steve and Garry, what?
I can't believe what I'm hearing. For one, I mean, to be serious about it, for one thing, the distinction that Steve and Garry have never been able to make to the satisfaction of some people is this matter of distance in death. When it happens close to them, they respond. We did a thing at the TV Academy the other day in which Steve, I think, made a very interesting differentiation between Paul Lynde's death and John Belushi's death. He didn't know Paul Lynde, and so he was doing material about it. John Belushi died. He knew Belushi, had a great deal of affection for him, and it wasn't a laughing matter, except maybe to the extent that it is at some later point. And yet, after the death of their friend, I'm driving down the road the other day listening to an extraordinarily funny and yet at the same time irreverent piece on the guy that went out and shot 56 people in Korea. This is a, and you took the wire, it is a, this guy is a genius. He takes plain, straight wire copy. Man's wife comes in, hits a fly that she thinks on it. He gets up, he's angry, he goes out and shoots 56 people. I'm kind of, as a journalist, interested in how is it that we as journalists can begin to make people understand that the whole world is human, and when somebody dies in Korea, it's a serious thing, and we ought to feel our humanity globally. And in a way, this man is just as irreverent about death, if it's a proper distance, than he's ever been. And yet, the great value of what he did is, I don't think I got out of the reading of the newspaper the kind of humanity that his irreverence finally put into the story. I'm feeling the story, even as he's irreverently, and I was kind of angry with him, chuckling at each shooting. Well, now, somebody lost family in that situation, you know.
Are you saying that what Steve and Garry do are profound in that area?
Well, I don't want to accuse them of being profound, but I am.
Don't do that.
Yeah, right. I mean, these guys are nice guys, but I do think that they have a way of stirring things up. I also happen to think that they have been for a long time. The brilliance of what they do is that they are preoccupied with both life and death. Their very program is like going, listening to their program is like going to an automobile race and secretly hoping for a crash. You wonder if they're going to kill themselves. On the air.
That boils down to, I guess, at times, is the word responsibility. And we've got to break away for commercial already.
Thank goodness.
Yeah, we're going to be back, though, with Steve Dahl, Garry Meier, John Callaway. And what do you think of the way the media, and maybe this media in general as well, Steve and Garry, handle death? I want you to share your view with us, 591-9000. We'll line your calls up and be right back.
Life isn't just for looking, it's for living. And that's what Lee's Carpet's all about.
Live the life of Lee's.
Some carpet is just for looking at. One is for living on. That's Lee's. More than 130 years in the business of helping people live more beautifully. With beautiful carpeting that lasts year after year after year.
Live the life of Lee's. The life of Lee's.
Jayz.
Put your munchy.
Jayz.
Put your crunchy.
Can stop eating us, Jayz.
Olé.
Olé.
Jayz.
Tortilla chips.
Jayz.
Great with deep.
Can stop eating us, Jayz.
Bueno.
Brown tortillas with a snappy crunch.
Tortilla chips.
Packed with a great big Mexican punch.
Bueno.
Can stop eating us, Jayz. Jayz. Tortilla chips.
Jayz.
Deep deep. Can stop eating us, Jayz.
Olé.
A pepper, original like a pepper. All you gotta do is taste.
Be a pepper.
To know the pleasure of a flavor you will treasure. All you gotta do is taste.
Be a pepper. Flavor's got a feeling, original and appealing. And all you gotta do is taste. Be a pepper.
Look for the wagon, J.L. Kraft's wagon, the horse and wagon with its natural cheese.
When the Kraft wagon is in sight, you know something special is inside.
Kraft Natural Cheddars and Colbys, rich, golden, fresh, as if J.L. Kraft had delivered them himself.
Look for the wagon, the Kraft cheese wagon.
When the Kraft wagon is in sight, you know something special's inside.
John Callaway made a mention of something that you talked about earlier to a confined group. I'd like you to be more specific with all of us now, right now. Why do you not pick on Belushi's death? Why do you pick on Paul Lynde? Why do you pick on Elvis, on Gacy? How did you differentiate between who you're going to satirize? Where did you draw the line?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I really don't know. What Garry and I both try to do with our radio show is be real. We don't decide before we go on the air, this is how we're going to be, this is how we're going to handle this. It just sort of evolves.
Do you talk about where we're going to stop? How far is this thing going to go? What's our responsibility?
No.
You don't talk, so you're basically just going out and...
We're just like two guys that we just go on and we say what we think.
All right, then somewhere in your mind, you are drawing the line.
Oh, sure, sure, as everyone should.
But where?
Well, it changes. It. You know, it goes back and forth.
Yeah.
What I said at the luncheon that we were at was that, to me, I can't help it, to me, Paul Lynde's death, it was not his death wasn't funny, but there was humor in it for me. Just because of the way he was, you know, oh, all right, and all that. He wasn't real to me. He was a one-dimensional character on my 17-inch television screen. So I can't be expected to feel a sense of personal loss because, you know, Hollywood Squares was not my life, you know.
All right.
But then John Belushi, I knew him, I met him, he touched my life, so I felt a sense of loss. The same with Marcus. I think we just become desensitized to death.
There's that word again, desensitized. Do you think the media in general does nothing but desensitize death?
Well, let's...
And John and Garry, please chime in if you
Well, I mean, you know, let's face it, the news is like the most profitable thing they have going here, other than your show, of course.
No,
and
you're,
so their
you're
job
right
is to go out and,
account.
You know, find death and destruction and package it and sell it. And
yes, but how many times have you seen on the news, yes, that death is reported, but also you see the families?
Yeah, screaming and wailing, you know, it's like a TV show.
But the point there is...
Well, it is a TV show, but I mean, it's like a, you know, it's not even real.
Right, but the point there is that they do recognize that there's family, that there is remorse, that there's victims afterward, that something continues on a very personal basis, that death
well,
is affected.
It never comes across to me. When we dealt with Marcus's death on the air, We got some incredible letters from people. I mean, just hundreds of incredible letters from people that really were...
Saying what?
Well, the point that I was going to make regarding the letters, we got several thousand. The one that sticks out in my mind
several
right
thousand.
Now, because I read all of them, he's still reading
I only read
50.
A couple hundred.
And the one that really, I guess, stuck in my mind was from this 20-year-old girl, same age as Marcus, who said, before Marcus's death, I never even... thought of death. And after he died, I became very scared of death because he was only 20 also. But she said, after I listened to how you treated his death, I didn't feel afraid of death anymore. So I think that's the feeling that we got over to the listener last week after we talked about Marcus's death and what he meant to
We've
us.
We've done bits.
And
on his, I mean, you know,
yeah.
Talking about him being in heavy, and he was heavy, but...
What did you feel that you had to do as a result of his
Well, we just talked about how we felt, and at some point, I decided, and Garry felt the same way, that he was in a, you know, a guy like Marcus, who was a totally good person, was in a, you know, I believe in, I don't know what, if you want to call it heaven or whatever, but that he was in a special place, and that I felt him looking down on me. And so we made jokes about that, and him being up in heaven saying, damn, Steve, look at all the press I'm getting and all this, you know, all that other stuff that's happening, you know, surrounding my death. And that made me feel better. And I think at some point you have to shut off. You can't deal with the reality of death too much or you go crazy because it is too scary.
I want to take a call before we got to break away again. Hi, good morning. You're on AM Chicago with us. We don't have a call?
No one
wants to talk to Steve or Garry or John? I thought you were more popular than that. All right. There are, I'm sure, people
I'll
who have
call.
Said, who
I'll
have said now, boy, I bet you they've learned their lesson. What do you say to them?
We've learned another lesson. I mean, is there only one lesson we have to learn? We've learned another lesson. We always learn lessons. But as I said, I don't regret anything I've done in the past.
John, media in general, let's go back and let's apply what Garry said something about, you know, what he's picked up is how to deal with death. Do you think we deal with death? Do you think when we're reporting those stories, do you think when we're handling situations of war and or individual shootings that we think about death in general?
No, we have so much of it, it's very difficult for people to know how to feel about it. And so people prepare themselves with kind of conventional piety, carry a little conventional piety over here and a little bit of personal piety over here. Uh-huh. And yet when you've got six persons killed in an automobile accident on the Dan Ryan and 400 persons have died when a ship sinks near the Falkland Islands and so on and so forth, and you're kind of moving around and we're kind of to pocket shooting this stuff out at you, we kind of hit you with all kinds of levels of death. And we're all going around. If I want to talk about, this is a book called The Denial of Death by Ernest Becker. And it's a book I want these guys to read someday when they grow up. Because,
why?
Because they'll love it. Because it is a book which is very close to their heart that talks about the risk-taking that you have to do in life and the foolishness of life and the foolishness of a religious belief and how we all really have a very deep fear of death throughout all of our lives. At the same time, we have a great love of life. And these things that you see in the newspapers and hear on radio and so on and so forth are a kind of subtle fabric of reminder of all of this, and yet we do it in such an objective, 27 persons died today when a plane crashed in Kenosha. That kind of stuff doesn't really, and what these guys finally do is they either stop and make fun of it, or now apparently they're stopping and doing some real grieving, and in a way they kind of mix up the ball game in a way that those of us who do conventional news don't. That is their value, and that sometimes is their tastelessness.
All right, and let's talk about that possible tastelessness and the fact that it does upset some people when we return, and maybe we'll try to get one of your calls. We'll send somebody out to call you.
Somebody call.
Yeah, we'll be right
I'll be
back.
Happy
stay with us.
Gee, where?
The whole story is finally told.
No! Stop it!
The conclusion of 79 Park Avenue.
Today at 3.
Here's a way to make homemade spaghetti sauce in minutes. Just mix water with new contadina Italian paste. It's real easy. Really. This is no ordinary paste. See, it has oregano, Romano cheese, oil, basil, garlic, already simmered in. Just mix and in minutes, delicious homemade sauce.
New contadina Italian paste. Spaghetti sauce in 10 minutes.
It makes homemade sauce easy. Really.
All across America, people are taking the Pepsi challenge. In Vermont, here's what they're saying.
Now that I've tasted Pepsi, I'd rather buy that.
I'm not surprised when you sit side by side that people pick Pepsi, because I think it does taste better.
Nationwide, more people prefer the taste of Pepsi over Coca-Cola.
It was an honest test, and I'm an honest person.
There's no comparison. Pepsi's a lot better. It has more taste.
I found out that I enjoyed Pepsi the best.
If you really want to be convinced yourself, try them side by side.
What will you say? Take the Pepsi challenge and find out.
Hi. Never thought I'd want to do a commercial, but here I am. For members-only jackets. Why? Because when I put one on, something happens. They feel fantastic. The colors are great, and all those different styles, absolutely terrific. They go anywhere, anytime. But it's only authentic if it says members-only right here. I really believe in them. So should you.
The man driving this car is an alcoholic. He needs professional help, the kind of help Care Unit can provide. Care Unit is the largest private provider of alcoholism treatment in the country. Not all alcoholics die from drinking. Some die just from being drunk. Call Care Unit before it's too late.
Now we have lined up some calls for Steve Dahl, Garry Meier, John Callaway. Good morning. You're on AM Chicago. Go ahead.
Yes. The point I wanted to make, there was two, matter of fact. Number one, we talk of desensitizing our feelings towards death, and I think the news does a good job in making us feel that way when we see the bloody shots on TV, mm-hmm. and it's sort of, we try to remove that from our mind. The second point I wanted to make is listening to Steve and Garry when they discuss about death. It, in a way, gives us a way to release our scare and our fear of death, and you know, we hear them. I don't consider it being irreverent. I think it's more humanized because we can bring ourselves to laugh at it a little bit.
And you think that's important?
I think it's very important because, let's face it, you know, as much as, like Garry says, you can learn about death, there's only so much you can learn. And with that fear of the unknown, I think we need to be able to chuckle a little bit about it.
Okay, thank you for your call. I want to take another one right away. Hi, good morning. You're on AM. Go ahead.
Yes, good morning, everyone. I have a message or a question for Steve and Garry. I'm an avid listener of yours. I've been away in Africa for the last 3 weeks. I just found out about it by tuning in this morning.
Good morning.
I just, my question is this. Knowing that you were kind of bringing up Marcus, both you and Garry, with you, kind of probably bringing him into your trio, so to speak, how did you deal with the negative questions and any negative views that people gave to you, especially being live and on the air? That's my question.
Well, negative, how?
I mean, if some people felt that you were dealing with Marcus's death and negatively, did any people approach you in that way?
The people who thought you were still making fun of death. Oh, no, no, we haven't received any negatives.
No?
No.
Most people who listen to you know what you're doing,
yeah.
Right? And it's the people who read an occasional newspaper column criticizing what you do, who don't like what you do. They're not listening to you regularly, are they?
All I know is that we received no negative comment. We came on the air and said what we thought, and said how we felt, and it seemed to be the way that everybody else felt about him.
Okay. All right. Let me go back to the phones for a second, Garry. Hi. Good morning. You're on AM.
Yeah, I was listening to what was going on.
Yeah.
And I was thinking about the issue of personal responsibility.
Right.
And I can remember about a year ago when a popular local sportscaster passed away suddenly. And his friends and associates at the station made some personal comments on the air.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, this is from a station that reports death and destruction and whatnot every day.
All right. Your point being?
The point is that really, how can you really draw a line between what you should say, what you should not say, what should be personal, what should be impersonal, in a medium that, by its very nature, is impersonal? I mean, it's a mass media. And can you really put the responsibility on any individual to start drawing lines immediately?
All right. John, let me turn to you on that one.
Well, sure. I mean, I think most of us are equipped to draw those lines. As I say, we carry a package of conventional piety around with us, or real feelings of loss, and we know how to articulate that. Our friends here don't have that kind of Geiger counter. Either their life experience hasn't been such, it's starting to become that. You cover a couple of wars, send these guys out to cover a couple of wars, a couple of riots in which people get killed. Their box of piety, both real and kind of made up, will start to change when that occurs. But in the meantime, they're going to be in touch with their feelings on public airways, and they're going to look dumb some days, and they're going to be brilliant other days.
John, answer me this, and I hate to kind of talk about you guys like you're the fourth wall that's missing, but
that's okay.
Do you think that would be better from a responsibility standpoint and being on the air if Garry and Steve had more life experiences and watched what they said a little bit more?
Well, I don't know whether it's better, because one might take a look at their career someday and say they were at their greatest when they were at their least aware about some of these things. I have mixed feelings about whether I want to see Steve Dahl grow up too much. I don't know whether I want him to read this book or not. I mean, it's the old question. Ernest Hemingway said, I won't undergo psychoanalysis because I don't want to lose my genius. And he blew his brains out. I mean,
You know what?
Okay, good
really,
morning. Good morning, everyone.
I think hit home out of all this was the letter we got from this guy who was very depressed and said he was very seriously contemplating suicide. The Marcus thing happened. He was listening and how he treated that. He said, I realized how short life really is, and I decided that I could get things together and not worry about killing myself so much. So maybe we saved a life in all of this. I hope so, because
it's entirely possible.
It really scared. I mean, I'm afraid to die. I'll be honest with you, and I don't know if that comes across when we talk about somebody like Marcus or Paul Lynn. Maybe we're just going, ha ha, that was him. It wasn't us again. It's like it didn't hit close enough.
Well, we're as afraid as everybody else. I used to think when we made fun of death, that I was doing mass media a favor by taking the black side and pointing that out, because everybody else was just smoothing it over, glossing
and
it
willing
over.
To take the guff and the rebukes that you got from
right. You know, like I pointed out the black side of the whole Gacy thing.
Yeah.
You know, I made it real. But now I think after Marcus's death, maybe I just was dealing with it in the only way I could, because I didn't want to make it. I actually wasn't making it real at all. I was just turning it into a bit so I didn't have to think about it.
You told me in an interview last summer that you said, well, you know, death is natural. Death comes to all of us. And you were just so mature
yeah,
and understanding and accepting.
Now.
I'm saying, wait a minute, come off.
Okay, but I'll admit it. See, I have a lot to learn, and I always admit that on the air, and I at least am open-minded and willing to learn.
You've just admitted it again, and Steve Dahl, thank you for being with us this morning. Garry Meier.
Thanks, Rob.
Always a pleasure chatting with you, gentlemen. And John, thank you for joining us also.
It's called survival of the fittest, and it's no game.
A passive survivalist is a dead survivalist.
Some of your neighbors are preparing for the worst. They're stockpiling food, learning to use weapons. They're watching out for themselves. But who's watching out for you? Watch The Survivalists, a special report by Joel Daly, tonight at 10 on Channel 7's Eyewitness News.
Bite into a taco, and this is what usually happens. My name is Tio Sancho, and I have made a taco shell that won't fall apart on you. Want to know my secret? Tio Sancho's taco shell is slightly thicker, crisp, but not so brittle. Look for my Tio Sancho taco shells, the taco shells that won't fall apart on you.
All across America, people are taking the Pepsi challenge. At a university in Mississippi, here's what they're saying.
I found that I do prefer Pepsi over Coke.
Pepsi tasted better.
Pepsi did taste better next to Coke.
Nationwide, more people prefer the taste of Pepsi over Coca-Cola.
Oh, that's the honest taste right there, no doubt about it.
The Pepsi really has more taste.
Coke is the real thing, but Pepsi's better.
Side-by-side test, it just shows me that Pepsi stands up better than Coke.
What will you say? Take the Pepsi challenge and find out.
Look for the wagon, J.L. Kraft's wagon, the horse and wagon with its natural cheese.
When the Kraft wagon is in sight, you know something special is inside. Kraft Natural Cheddars and Colbys, rich, golden, fresh, as if J.L. Kraft had delivered them himself.
Look for the wagon, the Kraft cheese wagon.
When the Kraft wagon is in sight, you know something special is inside.
I still have a few more seats for Tuesday's AM Chicago at the Apollo Theater for the Soap Stars performing. Give us a call right now at 591-9000 if you'd like to go next Tuesday. Have a good weekend. We'll see you on Monday.
Save on Venture's Mother's Day gifts of gold. Save 50% on our entire stock of 14-karat gold chains and bracelets. $24.99 buys this chain of hearts bracelet. Number one charms with diamond, just $12.99. Receive this brocade jewel case with any 14-karat gold or diamond purchase of $12.99 or more at no extra charge. Hurry, gold's on sale this week at Venture.
Save at Venture. Yeah, save with
Recently, in blind taste tests held in malls across the nation, Diet Cola drinkers tested the three leading Diet Colas. Diet Pepsi didn't win. Tab didn't win. Diet Rite Cola did win. In fact, more people preferred the taste of Diet Rite than either of the others. Taste the one that won. Delicious Diet Rite Cola. It's got what it takes to beat the best.
As you can see, the same long-distance call to the same place at the same time doesn't cost the same. Fact is, it can be half as much on MCI, the nation's long-distance phone company. If your long-distance bills are more than $25 a month, make one more call to MCI and join more than a million people across the country cutting those bills down to size. You haven't been talking too much, just paying too much.
Welcome to the Whitehall, one of the world's great hotels, located in the heart of Chicago's fabulous Gold Coast. Discover the Whitehall tradition of personal service and European atmosphere. Ask about our special weekend packages and treat yourself and your special friends to a new world of old world elegance and fine cuisine. Your key to comfort, relaxation, and enjoyment is waiting for you at the Whitehall.
Tender, meaty, jewel beef. The way it looks tells you it's choice quality. The prices tell you it's top value. Through Wednesday, round steak is $1.89 a pound at Jewel. Look for value in the farm stand market, too. Pick a big bunch of fresh broccoli for only 39 cents a pound. Through Wednesday at your Jewel.
We've been a friend of the family for 50 years. Jewel.
Is Viva a paper towel? Or isn't it? Watch. When it comes to absorbency, Viva's really a paper sponge. It may sound incredible, but Viva actually absorbs as much as this sponge. So Viva can sponge up your sloppiest spills, sponge up your drippiest drips. Incredibly absorbent Viva, the paper towel that's really a paper sponge.
Come to John M. Smith's great anniversary sale. Substantial savings throughout every department in all seven stores. Come to John M. Smith's anniversary sale on now.
Give to the Hadley School for the Blind.